And this is KC9DKV in CUSO with N9GTO. Good evening.
Good evening, sir.
And we are gathered here on 3815 for what purpose?
Have a little bit of chit-chat and talk about Milton Metz and talk about audio and talk about radio and just have a whole lot of fun.
Well, which one of those is going to come first?
Let's talk about Milton Metz. When did you first meet Milton, over?
I first met Milton in 1970 when I went to work for WHAS, and he was already a legend in 1970.
Now, at the time in 1970, was he doing a morning or afternoon show?
He was doing an evening show. He was doing his call-in Metz Here show about 7 p.m. to, I think, 11 or 10, thereabouts.
Wow. And how old were you then at 1970?
Oh, gosh, I don't know. But I wasn't, I was over 21 for sure. I knew what I was doing.
Okay. All right, well, we don't want to divulge too much, but anyway, wow. Wasn't he a weatherman for a while there?
Yeah, he functioned in TV just as well as in radio, but I didn't have much to do with the video aspect of WHAS, only in the radio side and in the production, and I was in North Carolina at the time at a station in, I was working for a group of stations called Smiles Broadcasting, which owned the legal limit of radio stations at that time, which was 6. And I was time to move along, and I had the option of going to Des Moines, Iowa, or Louisville, Kentucky, and I'd lived in Nashville as a kid of 16, and I worked for Reno Radio in Nashville, which was the only country music station in the country music capital of the world at that time. Of course, I wasn't a personality as such. I was a glorified board operator for... they would run remotes, quite a lot of remotes on the weekends, and so I would be a board op for the remotes, which is the guy that puts in the commercials and reads the news and stuff like that. But anyway, so I'd lived in Nashville, and so I had the opportunity of living in Louisville or in Des Moines, Iowa, so I picked Louisville. Roger, roger.
Well, let's go back just a little bit. When you were in Nashville at the time in in the 60s, late 60s, Nashville, you know, country music, I understand that you had the Grand Ole Opry, and they would be on WSM, is that right?
Oh, roger, roger, yeah. And it was really amazing because in the daytime, all those 50 KW stations were playing MOR music. But at nighttime, WSM became the country giant, and WLAC became the R&B giant. But in the daytime, they were both like MOR music.
Right, right. Yeah, and then you had the, what a lot of people don't know, you had the big swing music, the big band. It's a country swing before, you know, in the early 1900s, and you had the big band era. The different ones, the big Glenn Miller and all those as well, and you had various split offs. And country music back then with the Grand Ole Opry, it was a little bit different than it is today. Everything seems to have taken a different direction at very, times of the year, 73, 75, 77, after the death of the king as well. But getting back to Milton Metz, 95 years of being on this earth, that is something else to, he passed away on January the 12th of 2017 at 95 years old. So I would say that you really, at the time you were young, you met a guy that was awesome, and you had a good career, and you was able to go on with it. you couldn't ask for anything else. Being young like that's kind of like serving the apprenticeship, over.
Oh, roger, roger. Yeah, I came to WHAS for a reason, and one of those reasons was that I was technically inclined as well as commercially producing commercials and programs. So I had a technical understanding that was as equal with my production. And at the time, WHAS was going through a, shall we say, a growing pain, growing curve, and that the station manager, Hugh Barr, was interested in what was called combo at the time. And combo was the ability for the on-air jock to run his own control board, and for production people to be able to operate their own control boards. To that point, the engineers had jurisdiction over almost all moving parts, and it was their hands that were at the controls. And so Hugh wanted a more, how shall we say, gliding kind of a production on the air, as opposed to a kind of a stilted you tell them what and then they have to do kind of thing, whereas if you're doing your own thing, it's going to be a lot smoother. And he recognized that. So you know, I was like the canary in the cage in that I would work with three engineers doing my controls in the control room, Studio A, master control, and so I would work on a daily basis with three engineers on two-hour shifts, and it was a matter of them, you know, well, I was kind of trailblazing for Hugh as far as being the canary in the cage, as to reading between the lines as far as what the engineers were saying to management and what really was happening there. And so it was kind of like blazing a trail between two unions, my AFTRA and their engineers union. And you have to be very careful when you're running between two unions there, because either one of them, if you screw up, will step on you.
So basically what you're saying is you were riding the fence.
No, I was in the trenches, actually, you know, trying to get a job done, and it became a situation where, you know, not only was I telling them what to do, but it became necessary to tell them how to do, because you know, it was a matter of efficiency, and we developed quite a few production techniques. One was called Editech, which is basically two Ampex stereo machines lashed together that you could edit machine to machine in a way that was similar to video editing. And we saved a lot of time making audio edits that way versus the you know, doing a splice edit.
So basically you were there when they became the 24-hour operation.
Roger, yes. Uh-huh. And we again tried to facilitate everybody's situation, you know, and obviously when one union acquiesces on a particular point, it usually involves money, you know, and so it's just a matter of time and money. And eventually Hugh got his combo on the air and in production.
That was amazing. At the time, it was ruled by the Bingham family, which owned and published the Louisville Courier Journal and Louisville Times. Wow. such a big family and a big thing going on, and all the changes that took part. Wow. Just absolutely amazing. But at the time, at that era, it was a great, great station to listen to. Over.
Roger, yes, it was had been for many years a clear channel station, and that's when the clear channel actually meant something. That you know, they had a signal over 3/4 of the United States, and that was one of the reasons that I decided not to go to L.A. or Chicago or New York, because I could compete on a national level in radio without having to go to those metropolises, because WHAS did penetrate 3/4 of the country, and so that was the neat part about a Clear Channel station. Unlike you know, this company that took the name Clear Channel, which is the height of I don't know what you would call that, but certainly they never lived up to their name. Clear Channel, you know, and then when people realized what a terrible company they were, they just changed their name and started anew all over again.
Now, what is the MOR music, the old line MOR music? What is the meaning of that? In the early 70s, they modernized the MOR music. What was that?
So basically a general type of music programming, you know, not rock and roll, but middle of the road. That's you know, what MOR stood for, middle of the road. And you know, it was before talk radio. And you know, it just unfortunately I got, well, fortunately for me, I spent 50 years in broadcasting when creativity meant something. Today, there is no creativity in radio. Clear Channel, iHeartRadio has almost single-handedly destroyed the commercial radio operation in America.
And we'll pause for station identification. This is N9GTO with KC9VKV.
KC9 VKV with N9GTO, and we were talking about commercial radio and WHAS and Milton Metz, and like I say, Milty had a great life, and you know, the opportunity for that kind of a life in broadcasting today is almost non-existent, not possible, because of the elements that are involved in the ownership, mainly iHeartRadio. 1,400 radio stations are sitting on the precipice of disaster. They're sitting underfunded. iHeartRadio has managed to pull every cent that they can out of these, just suck the blood right out of these 1,400 radio stations, and just work. They were caught recently trying to smuggle $20 million out of the country from another organization of the iHeart umbrella that actually made some money, and they were trying to shelter that money from their investors by getting it out of the country into offshore bank accounts. And unfortunately for them, their investors caught wind of it, and because it was an illegal act, the investors sought to retrieve all of their financial considerations that were outstanding due immediately, because iHeart was trying to become involved in illegal operations. And they went to a judge in Texas and sought, you know, a relief from the possibility of trying to repay all this money that they have no way of repaying. And the judge sided with them that they would give iHeartRadio some more time to come up with the capital, which is where they are at the moment.
Wow, sounds like they're living on borrowed time, and that's just my point of view of it. Switching gears just a little bit, do you remember when Gary Burbank, when he left WAKY in 73, he had an elaborate prank about pretending that he was fatally shot by a disgusted listener? Do you remember that?
Well, let's see. Was that who shot JR?
I'm not sure. At that point, he moved to New Orleans for a brief stint with a WNOE in New Orleans. Of course, Burbank was all over the place. You know, he was having some fun, and I think he wound up back at WHAS. You know, after it was all said and done, or.
Well, I think he went to, let's see, yeah, he went to Canada also there on that trip, and then came back from Canada to HAS, as I recall the situation. But Gary is also one of the greatest broadcasters, I think, that this country's ever seen, or even the world, actually. There, you know, I've never run across a radio quote announcer that is more creative than Gary. He would do like 15 bits a day religiously, you know, and there's nobody that does 15 pieces of production a day for their show.
Oh, I agree. I enjoyed the Earl Pitts. The full-blooded redneck who makes a daily commentary on everything from political to family and friends.
Roger, well, he had a whole cast of characters, well-rounded, and the thing about it is, though, that Gary was, let's see how to put this, high-strung, as well as he, you know, might be that creative, and it would not be uncommon. I would come in to the production room after he finished, and there would be a chair hanging out of the wall baffle. Now, for those that don't know what a wall baffle is, in radio studios or in audio studios, they put rounded baffles on the walls, which are like rounded plywood pieces that make the sound, instead of bouncing back and forth, it diverts the sound and thereby minimizes echoes and things. And so these are basically what you would say plywood baffles, and so there would be a chair sticking in out of the baffle. That somebody had gotten so upset that they slammed thrown a chair into the baffle. Just one of the things, you know. If it had been a person, man, it would be the job for the EMS for sure.
Oh yeah, and he used to be Reverend Deuteronomy Skaggs, the preacher that encouraged all his listeners to dig deep in their jeans and pull out the greens. Skaggs and old Bernice and all of them, they was a character in those days, and old Ranger Bob, and oh Lord, on and on and on. So like you said, 15 stints a day, that was a hell of a thing.
Roger, KC9VKV within 9GTO. I was one afternoon walking to the parking lot with Gary, and we were just about to our cars when we were approached by a band of Hare Krishnas ringing their bells and dancing around, and I wasn't real sure whether we were trying to be saved or robbed, but Gary broke into his Deuteronomy Skaggs character and just told them, you know, that they were going to hell and their lives would never be the same, because he would personally speak to God about them, and they were so afraid they just took off running, and they weren't afraid of going to hell, they were afraid of Gary.
Did you ever meet a man named David Dick?
No, name sounds familiar, but I don't recall.
Okay, just kind of, you know, just for one, David Dick, John Zelliger, Kaywood Leopard.
Oh yeah, Kaywood. Kaywood is one of the all-time great sportscasters in the world. Called the Kentucky Derby many times, and also did a great stint in basketball.
Yeah, he's also, yes, yeah, he's a native of Harlan County.
Right, right. Yeah, and Van Vance. Van is great also as far as basketball. Van, first time I met Van Vance in our combo operation, you would be the jock would be on the air with his control board, and then there would be, for all practical purposes, a table on the other side of the control board, and the news people would come in and sit down at that table and do their newscast from there, and then the sports guys would come and do theirs from the same place. And the first time I met Van, he was doing that, and Van, you know, he spoke so low. He was down here like this, a very low voice. But the thing is, you know, as you speak, as you gain lower resonance, you lose the decibels. Your voice gets very soft as it gets low. And I could not hardly hear him acoustically in the room. It was only the microphone that he was working on, and he just sounded like 20 feet tall on the microphone, but in the room you could barely hear him.
Oh, yeah. And one of the things about old Ledford was he would get on there and say, "Hello, everybody, this is Kay Wood Ledford." I'll never forget that.
Well, yeah, he was every bit in his own right as Milty was, truly a star, a sage star. He was, he knew what he was doing, and he had a career that people today would just envy.
And this all started with a tube and your grandfather, right?
Yeah, Roger, yeah, my grandfather was on the air before the FCC.
That's awesome. That is absolutely awesome. But, yeah, there are so many different aspects of radio, like amateur radio, that with broadcasting, television, TV, all the different things, and technology is changing. Like it was back in the 70s and 80s, it's constantly changing. Either you change with the times, or the times will change you. And that's what happens to a lot of them. But the ones that are really can stay in there, such as Kay Wood and Metz and all of them, they have definitely left their mark on the industry. And he will be missed, definitely, at the Crusade for Children. That's something that everyone loved to see Uncle Milty. Back to you.
Oh, Roger, yeah, and the Crusade for Children, you can't talk enough about that. That was one of the things when I first came to HAS that I was found so outstanding, is that organization just, put on the greatest show, and all the money that they got from the contributions, 98% of that money went to the groups that were, you know, in need of it, and there was very little money that was used for the operation, the actual physical operation of the Crusade for Children, unlike a lot of other organizations that will take maybe 50%, 60% of the cash flow right off the top and delegate it for their overhead. You know, that's ridiculous.
Well, you know, it was amazing. In 1956, they raised $187,000.
Right, that's chicken feed compared to what they're doing now. I mean, what they were doing, $6 million, I think.
Oh, it's unbelievable. It's actually unbelievable. The legacy that they have, everything they've done, you name it, it's just absolutely a great organization. To me, the organization, as a child, they actually provided hearing tests for children that had special hearing tests and stuff that the normal families could not afford, and WHAS was there.
Right, the Crusade for Children. And I tell you what, how apropos this may be, let's end this with a vignetted program of the Crusade for Children. This was recorded back in the 70s, and it actually is a vignette of the complete program, and I think this would be very apropos. Remember the Crusade for Children and in donations.
Dissolve quad split. Take camera three. Stand by. Cue bell.
It's a most unusual day. Feel like throwing my worries away. If my heart won't behave in the usual way, well, there's only one thing to say. It's a most unusual, most unusual, most unusual day.
This is the 1979 Crusade for Children. From Kentuckiana and all across the country have come television and recording stars and hundreds of volunteers who have offered their services. But here are the real Crusade stars, the mentally and physically handicapped children of Kentucky and southern Indiana. Whether or not their lives can be made worthwhile depends on you.
There are people eating people. There is sunshine everywhere. There are people. And a feeling of spring in the air. The most unusual time. I've been feeling my temperature climb. If my heart won't behave in the usual way, well, there's only one thing to say. It's a most unusual, most unusual, most unusual. Yes, it's a most unusual day.
Ceremonies for the next 24 hours, Mr. Crusade, Jim Walton.
Thank you so much. And this is the reason we're all here tonight, for Sheila Theiler. She needs a helping hand, and I think we're going to give it to her. Tomorrow, when that last diamond dollar has been dropped into the fishbowl, she and thousands like her will say, thank you so much. You've done it again. Speaking of thanks, we'd like to thank some other people, Judy Marshall and Joanne Hale, of course, the Patsy Blurt dancers, Dave Jones and his motet singers, and, of course, our big Crusade Orchestra directed by Mel Owens. Now, you know the purpose of the show. You've been here 25 years with us, I think, most of you. And you know we're here to raise as much money as we possibly can to help as many handicapped children in Kentucky and southern Indiana as we can. And our first entertainer is an actress and recording artist. And last night, someone said to her, what are you going to sing? And I think I can quote her almost verbatim. It was something like, honey, I'm going to do it all. Della Reese.
Just to be alive. I wish I may, I wish I might. Wish away your lonely nights. Ah, come on, ah, let's fly. You've been hurt so bad by the lives you've had that you close the door. You've been crying so long that you don't believe that you can laugh anymore. But this is another part of life, you see. Life is bitter, but life is sweet. Even darkness can bring you light. Ah, trees.
to know is, where is the energy shortage, huh?
Oh, listen, that's very sweet. But, I'm going to say this because I'm a stranger in town. And I've only
been
here...
You're not a stranger anymore,
well,
I'll tell you that.
Thank you. I've only been here a couple of days, and I've learned a few things about this crusade in the last couple of days and about the people who run this crusade. They worked very hard for this crusade for you, and it's your turn to work very hard and show that their efforts have not been in vain. So while you're sitting there enjoying the show and enjoying the efforts of these people, please call. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Okay, I'm looking over and I'm seeing a man who has all of those gold records. Bobby Rydell.
Let me get out there. For that band, huh? You must have thought that I was lonely. You came to my rescue. But now I know this must be hell. How could so much love be in? I swear it's true, it's all I can do. Can't you see this one's for you? This one's for you. This one's for you. For you.
Let's welcome back once again Mr. Dean Shepherd.
More than the greatest love the world has known, this is the love I give to you alone. More than the simple words I try to say, I only live to love you.
Total on the board right now is 86,948 at about 12 minutes before midnight. This is Miss Yvonne Over.
Memories like the corners of my mind. Misty watercolored memories of the way we were.
Is our board fixed back here yet? Yeah, I can read it now. $93,499. This is the fellow who is the all-night DJ, I'll have you know. From WKRP up in Cincinnati, that's just up the pike a piece. And you know him, of course, as Venus Flytrap. Let's welcome Tim Reed. Tim?
I've heard it for a while.
Sound familiar?
Oh, yeah. That's nice.
Well, what do you think of the kids?
I've fallen in love with a little young girl over there. She's crying now, of course, because I've gone.
You've gone away.
Yeah. What's your name again?
April.
April, all right. And you have some money for me, is that right? Thank you, April. Wow, that's a lot of money. Well, can I get a kiss? Ah, it's all about love, isn't it?
Now, welcome Pee-wee King.
I was waltzing with my darling to the Tennessee Wall when an old friend I happen to see. I introduced him to my loved one the night they were playing the beautiful Tennessee Waltz.
Can we do a little camera switch here and go over and find Gary Burbank somewhere with
you? Don't have to find him. Now watch him, Dale.
We're going to find Gary somewhere because he is the one that is talking with the lovely young ladies who take your pledge when you call. Gary, isn't that true?
Yes. You could be talking through this, and it could be going into her here right on television.
Guess who I saw coming in here this morning?
Who?
Porky Chadwick.
You're kidding.
First time I've ever seen him this time of the morning.
This is when he's out normally. Now, these ladies are from South Central Bell. Two of them are from the Kentucky State Home for the Not Quite All There, I'm telling you right now. Strange. What is your name?
Sandy Donahue.
Sandy? Okay, thank you. You hung up on somebody just when I asked your name? Okay, but like, you know our telephone number, so give us a call. I got a few pledges to read. Mr. and Miss Jackie Trent of 5118 Fay Avenue, $5. Frank and Ellie Bird, Madison, Indiana, $24. Mr. and Mrs. Francis B. Whitehouse, Jr., 1301 Abbeywood Road, $120. Jerry, you got some pledges?
I sure do, Gary. And we just had someone walk up to the back door a while ago with a $5 pledge, $5 in cash, that is, in memory of Howard Stinson III.
$10,208?
Yes.
So that's tremendous.
The square dancers are on their way. Look out, fire departments.
I'm Jim Michelle with Convenient Food Marts. We are happy to announce that this year's grand total is $8,000.
$6.91.
Oh, all right. $6.91. Can you go ahead and put it in there? Oh, got to open up all the way. $6.91 out of the Taylor Brothers here.
I'm John Clark with General Electric, and I'm chairman of the Employee Community Fund, which represents all of the employees at General Electric.
General Electric Employees Community Fund to the Crusade for Children. $60,000.
Salem, Indiana, and Larry Brown's got a few words for us.
This year we have $10,197.92.
All right. It's $10,192.
Fisher Packing Company. This amount that they are giving this year amounts to $32 per employee. That total, and I'll say this one out loud, is $16,000.
We're getting close to $300,000. Look at that, $296,898.
Okay, we're over here with the St. Matthews Fire Department with Rick Albers and Kenton Lonahan. Okay, what's the grand total?
Gives us a grand total of $25,500 even.
That is remarkable.
Mutual is here.
We think we'll just give you a figure and then we go home. $19,187.10.
$19,000!
It looks like a bunch of people from Middletown to me.
That's right.
I can tell them a mile away, Jerry.
What's your total?
The grand total this year is $20,004.41.
Oh, my gosh!
I'm here with the South Dixie Fire Department, and Chief, you have a few things to say?
We'd like to give this in memory of Charles Lee, the past chief of South Dixie Fire Department. A total of $16,670.40.
Oh, fabulous. From the South Dixie Fire Department, let's listen to it.
The Archbishop is with us, and this means a very dramatic point in our birth. You don't bring any boots full of money, but...
No.
You bring the word.
We bring the word. That's important. Today's the word to get it out. Evangelization is the word.
Right.
So our grand total this year is $67,700.75.
Got another group of 30 or 40 volunteer fire department people, scouts, McMahon Volunteer Fire Department, and they got a new record.
And our grand total this year...
Grand total this year...
is $19,000
even. $19,000
even
from the McMahon Volunteer Fire Department. How about that? Brilliant.
We are ready over here. We have got the Okolona Fire Department with a cast of thousands.
$41,500.
Wow. $41,000. Put her in there. We are here with a group from Camp Taylor. This thing gets more incredible as we roll along. It's amazing. As you'll note on the board, we are approaching $900,000. And with Pat Wright, the chief at Camp Taylor,
our total for this year's 1979 Crusade, $23,739.83.
Fantastic. That's it.
I want you to pay attention to some very important initials. This is Milton Metz, and PRP stands for one of the great organizations, Pleasure Ridge Park Fire Department. When they come, silence reigns because they come strong, men, women, and children. And we don't know what they're bringing, but they're bringing a lot of good things.
And we have a grand total of $58,356.68.
I have lots of people, as you can easily see here, representing the Fern Creek Volunteer Fire Department.
The grand total was $17,189.86.
Oh, and that's something from Fern Creek Volunteer Fire Department. Over $17,000. Kevin, let me get out of the way.
Now the great thing comes forward from
the Clark County Citizens Group.
Right. And we have $48,725.87.
Yay! Great!
This is Mr. George Krause from over in New Albany.
How you doing, Mr. Krause? My pleasure.
Is your daughter standing next to him?
Hi. How are you?
She's been a fan of yours since she was a teenager. Get over there and make her happy, huh?
I can't give you an exact figure because we're still kind of counting money over in New Orleans. Still has some money coming in. But I can tell you this. It is in excess of $30,000.
In excess of $30,000.
Phyllis, before the show, you remember you wrote something down in the book, and you wrote down your guess and my guess on the end of the show.
I think
we split it about 50-50.
We just about did, didn't we?
Uh-huh. Mm-hmm. You said 200, 1,200,000. I said 1,225,000. It comes out 1,217,572.
You know, our joy at this fantastic total is tinged with sorrow today because Jim is retiring. And Jim, you know, we found no way to package love and respect, but knowing your love of silver, we have a little gift for you. And I want to say it will be etched, and this is what it will look like. Wayne, would you hold it for the camera, please?
It's a show.
With our love, Jim.
Too much. Thing I can think to say is I think personally I've gotten more out of it than anybody else has. I mean, it's been a wonderful experience, and one I'll never forget.
Well, we'll never forget you, Jimmy, and we come to the time when we must say to the community, thank you. Today we'd like to say you are the most generous people in the entire world. Each of you, from those of you who gave a quarter to $10,000. We hope you feel very proud of the total of the Crusade for Children for this 26th year. Those of us who have brought you the Crusade are glad that we could be a part in providing the setting for your generosity so that all of our handicapped children will have a much better life.
God bless America.